Dundee, George. Mm-hmm. I got up on Saturday morning and said, that game's no going on. To be fair, some of the best golf courses in the world with the best drainage of any sports facilities in the world in this area couldn't function for 2 days over at St Andrews, Carnoustie and King's Barnes for the whatever cup it is, Dunhill Cup. So you can't really expect Dundee. But it did occur to me now that Dundee have repurchased their stadium, maybe a wee bit of work on the drainage would be...
Well, I think the problem is beyond their control, I think, is the issue. It's the drainage down on Dens Road that backs up, that causes a problem. And you can imagine when there's that amount of rain that
yes, that's what I say. We should stress that on this occasion, we, despite what the weather forecast said, we were the epicentre of the rain. And there was no chance of a football pitch or any outdoor sports facility in this area being playable last weekend.
I'm trying to think of a Dundee home game that hasn't been absolutely pouring down, to be fair, this season. Even the first game of the season was probably... It's probably the one game where it's been closest to getting called off and didn't get called off that I've been at in a long time. They were actually on the pitch during the game to push water off it in that one. And that's the first game of the season. But the last week, I mean, I was out and about on the Friday. I just had a T-shirt on. It was lovely. It was nice and warm. And I thought, oh, this would be great for a football game tomorrow. And then I looked at the forecast that, it's not going to happen. So, it's been a bit... unfortunate with the timing of these really, really heavy spells of rain seem to be on Saturdays when Dundee are playing at home. But the game's in the book already. It's going to make things a wee bit tighter. When we kick off again in a couple of weeks, it's Aberdeen, Ross County, Livy, Rangers. And then there's another game on the weekend. So it's Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Wednesday, Saturday.
Tuesday, October the 24th, the game has been rearranged for... It's a blow to Dundee, isn't it? Because after a decent start to the season, a very good result at Easter Road the week before, this was a chance to keep a good run going.
They have built up a wee bit of momentum, certainly good for them, shall we say. You know, they started the season relatively well. They've shown positive signs, as I said last week. They're looking more and more like a Premiership side. I'm not a big fan of the way the league is interrupted because international breaks, but we just have to live with that. And now on top of that, you throw in a game that's postponed because of the weather. And, you know, it'll be nearly 3 weeks when Dundee play their next game since they've played. And that's a worry because, you know, the manager, although they've been on the training ground for the majority of that time, the manager will be concerned that you just lose that, you know, that all the good stuff that you've done, you worry if it's going to be, you're going to be a bit stuttery when you get back. But it's up to them to get going again when they do get up to Aberdeen next Saturday night, another evening game to look forward to. They've got to say, you know, it was a good call from Dundee to make the early call. They're playing Ross County, you know, it saves any fans making the journey. I mean, the game was never, ever in a million years going to be playable. And the last thing you want, I mean, Dundee are playing some decent stuff at this point in time. The last thing you want is a game being on and turning into an absolute farce. So it's victory could be based on the ball sticking in the water. And players can get injured as well. So, yeah, it was the right call. There's no way that game
could way Dundee want to play, they want a good pitch for the rest of the season.
That's absolutely right. I mean, so there was no way that game could have been played. So they've just got to get on with it now. I'm sure Tony Docherty will have fixed up a couple of bounce games
a reserve game on Tuesday against Dundee United.
Right.
I wonder how many.
Where is that taking place? Do you know?
North End, maybe.
Right, okay. I think. Is that in the evening or?
No, afternoon.
Right, okay.
So I'd be interested to see how many first teams.
Playing a game at North End and they've no told you there.
No, I know.
There's a statue of you at North End.
They've completely forgotten about me up there now.
I think it's there. They had a testimonial as well. They were the testimonial opponents for Stirling Albion's Ross McGeechie. And Tony
Duthie. I always preferred McGeechie.
It might be McGeechie, yeah. Tony Dockett sent a strong team to that one. It was stronger than I expected. I thought it would be a Dundee select type thing, but it was very much first teamers who weren't away on international duty. Or
and did you go?
No.
Heads the. Oh, it was stronger than I expected. I was led to believe it would be a first team. So you could have been watching a first team squad game and you missed it.
It could have been, yeah.
I thought you hated time off.
I did, but it was, I had other stuff to do during the day, that's all. In terms of work, I wasn't just hanging about doing my own stuff. But it would have been good to see Diego Pineda back on the pitch in dark blue because he got a run out and we haven't seen him in a while. Mo Salah got a game as well. We haven't seen him because Boateng's been really, really good. Difficult to dislodge. So Lee Ashcroft got a game. I'm trying to think of Legston's was in goal. It's guys that haven't been getting a chance. Just, even if it's a testimonial, it's maybe not highest competitive action, but they're getting a run out. Luke McCown scored, Jack Wilkie scored as well in the 2-2 draw. So the guys are getting games, but it's really not ideal having 3 weeks off, is it?
No, but as I say, the international break always annoys me, especially if you've been going well and you've got to stop. But it's the way it's been for years now, the first 3 months of the season.
Well, it's interesting. I saw yesterday somebody suggested they should have an international season.
Yeah.
Just stop at the end of the season between April and May or whatever. You just put all the international games in one go and stop and have the club season for a different part of the day.
And you know what? The benefit of that could be if they were brave enough to try that. I always think the close season's so short now that people sort of drift back. Whereas if you finished in April, who knows? Maybe come mid-July, start of August, fans are chomping at the bit to see their team again.
Mm-hmm. The only problem I can see with that is international season at the end of a season is if there's a European Championships or a World Cup and it's in the summer, you have the international
Champions
season
League
and,
final.
And, then, well, be the same. And then you'd move right from the international season, you'd qualify and then you just move into another.
No, I think that would probably be the international season.
So that would be it, yeah.
I guess, I don't know.
Bear makes a very good point there, George, that we didn't think of, but he's still a spoiled sport, if you ask me. Talking of international breaks and bringing it back to Dundee, I was very disappointed that Owen Beck never got some sort of run out for Wales last night against Gibraltar.
I'm even more disappointed that I watched the entire second half waiting to see if he'd come in. That's the commentator said, with about 15 minutes to go, they've no more subs left, so
I didn't quite understand this. They seem to made six subs by around the start of the second half or very
half
early.
Time,
I think maybe one of them was there was an injury early on that Wales had to make a change, but they made six subs and then 45 minutes of nothing.
I think the manager probably because he's done so well at Dundee, this has been flagged up to him, and I think the manager just wants to get him involved and wants to get him involved in the full team setup. And he'll just, I've seen Steve Clarke doing the same sort of thing, and you have to wait your time. You have to bide your time. You know,
Robbie Savage's laddie, didn't he? He got 90 minutes.
I'm sure Beck's chance will come. The way he's been playing, he's been one of the outstanding players for Dundee this season. You look at I noticed, George, did you do a thing with the top five players this week? Or was that just in one of the chats? But, I mean, for Dundee, you'd be looking at Beck, certainly. You'd be looking at possibly the goalkeeper, Alex Shaughnessy. I think he's done well. You spoke about Luke McKim, he's been outstanding this season. But they've got one or two others who are playing at a very high standard. And that's something that they're going to have to continue, because while they've done well, when you look at the league table, They're sitting third bottom at this point in time. It is very tight. It is early days.
You made a key point. Their form's good.
Yeah.
The results can be better.
Yeah, possibly. I mean, I think when you look at it, certainly they threw away a couple of points at St Johnston that day, certainly, with late lapses. But then they clawed that back the other week there with the late goal. So, you know, these things happen in seasons. You've just got to... I think the manager, again... Just like Jim Goodwin across the road, will be very satisfied with the way his team is playing, with the fact he's brought in a lot of new players to You know, we spoke about United's defence, Dundee's defence is practically entirely
made more changes all over the pitch even than Jim Goodwin's made.
So they've just got to keep on going and keep doing good things. The guys who are out the team, you've spoken about so many first team players who got a run out in that friendly, George, who must be, again be chomping at the bit to get in. But they're looking and saying, how do you get in when the team's playing well? You've just got to bide your time. And when you get the opportunity, take it. Make sure you take it. That's what I would say to anyone. If you get the opportunity, you know, don't let it slip. Because I'm sure Tony Docherty will be honest. And if somebody does a job on the park for him, he will keep retain that jersey the next week. But it was disappointing that, because I felt that the game against Ross County was an opportunity to go and get another victory. I think that was the thing. Well, the start of the season, well, they've only got the one win on the board at this point in time. That was going to be an opportunity. No disrespect to Marky Mackay and his side, who have given Dundee big problems in the past at Dens Park. It would have been a tough game, but it was a real opportunity to go and get 3 points. And had they done that and been sitting at 10 points at this point in time, you know, the league table would have looked much better.
I was going to say there, Alan, I mean, perception's everything, but I'm looking at a league table just now. Dundee are on 7 points, 3 points above the bottom, in 10th place. Had they beat Ross County last weekend, if the game had gone ahead, they'd now be sitting in sixth. Only 3 points better off, but during an international break, a much better feeling for everybody.
100%. And that's the real frustration about the fact that it was the Ross County game that didn't go ahead, because it feels like we've been talking for a couple of weeks now about the fact that they're putting together some creditable results and the performances are relatively good, but the games against St Johnstone and specifically at home to Ross County were the ones where you go, right, let's turn that into 3 points and put a bit of breathing space, and then you can sort of decide whether it has been a good start to the season or whether you're going to be reflecting on plaudits but no prizes kind of thing. So I think that will be a real element of frustration, and it would have been a real, you know, wouldn't define the season, but it would. I feel like it would almost have defined the way you look at the start of the season if they could have got 3 points against Ross County and that game had gone ahead. But as you guys touched on, what I would also say is I've covered enough games that have been ruined by wind and rain and then become a toss of a coin. And you know what? See if you're going to be looking back at the end of this season on crucial games between, whether it's Dundee, Ross County, Dundee, St Johnstone, Livingston, whoever it may be, you don't really want any of those crucial 3 points to have felt like they were decided on the toss of a coin because of terrible conditions, puddles, wind, all that sort of thing. So I think it was a sensible decision.
Aye. And there is a wee concern there, Bear, that you want to accumulate points while you're playing well, because very few teams don't have a bad patch in the season.
Yeah, and Dundee have been doing that. That was the big thing for me coming into the season. They had to pick up points on a regular basis, and they've done that. We've seen Dundee in the past coming up to league, maybe getting a win here, but then going six games without picking up a point or just picking up 1 point. They look as though they're capable of getting points in every game, and hopefully, you know, they can keep doing that. And that is based, I have to say, on defensive solidity. The goalkeeper, the two centre-backs, the two full-backs, I've got to say, have done well. It's been Beck on one side, whether it's been Cammy Kerr or you know, whether it's been Jordan McGee. They've done really well. They've been well-disciplined. The team looks as though it's got a great shape about it. You know, we've spoken on various times, what sort of shape are Dundee playing? 4-4-2, 3-5-2. Yeah.
It does like to change it.
Whatever happens, they all seem to know what they're doing. And I've not seen any, they've very rarely been exposed. I mean, I can't remember. We've seen it so often in the past where you go, this one man just breaks from the halfway line, running through on the Dundee goal, and you're going, where's the defence gone? That just hasn't happened. They look as though they've been well drilled on what they've got to do. So that gives you hope going forward. They've got a real tough one coming up against Aberdeen because Aberdeen, Barry Robson's come in for a wee bit of stick up there because of the way they've started the season. They put a couple of wins on the board, but then again, St Johnstone go up there and fair play to St Johnstone, do a good job and come away with a decent point. Now, that's going to make it even tougher for Dundee going up there next Saturday.
But Aberdeen are hard to predict. They can get big results and they can get very, very poor results.
When they're the sort of team, when they're firing, they're the really impressive side. But I think, I go back to when Jim Goodwin was in charge. Some of those players are still there. And the reason Jim Goodwin ended up getting the sack was because they didn't perform on a regular basis. And unfortunately,
there is a fragility.
On nearly a regular basis, as they should have done. So I'm hoping that's a sort of Don's performance we get next week when Dundee are up at Pittodrie.
I would prefer to play them like St Johnstone did on the back of a European game, though, rather than on the back of a week's training or 10 days training or whatever, a couple of weeks, that they've managed. I don't know how many players they've got away on international duty, but that's, I think that's something they're having to deal with this season is group stage football in Europe, which is a lot different to their usual seasons over the past few. And I think that St Johnston maybe got them at a good time on that, after that. But I don't see any reason why Dundee can't go up there and really be really competitive and pick something up, because they showed that at Hibs that they can do that. And they look like a team that can do it fairly regularly.
Dundee have showed it in a few away games this season. Unfortunately, a few of them have also ended in defeat, but for long periods of games and for 90 minutes against Hibs, they can stop teams playing.
Yep, they've done. And as I said, I mean, have you watched the highlights of the Hibs game? It looked like Hibs absolutely murdered Dundee, and that wasn't quite a true reflection of the game. Dundee played a lot of good controlled stuff when they were on the ball, but obviously they don't make highlights. It's chances to make highlights. Mm-hmm. And Dundee had two or three good chances in that game, but they need to find somebody who's going to put the ball in the onion bag, George. Who's, you know, we spoke about Louis Moult at United. Who's going to be Dundee's man who's going to step up to the plate on a regular basis and start finding the back of the net? Because there's a chance. It was, you're talking about Pineda. We've not seen a lot of him. He looks very slight to me. But if he can come on and start finding the net, he'll get in the team, because there isn't really anyone. I've got to say, Bakayoko,
I like Bakayoko,
to me, looks the most complete forward at this point in time, because he's an experienced guy. I think Zach Grodin's working his socks off to stay in that team, and hats off to him, but he needs to improve his overall play. You know, that will come with him. He's still a young man. He also has to find more goals. There's an opportunity there for someone at Dench to step in and, you know, say, listen, I'm going to be the main man here and get goals every week.
And there's Zach Robinson as well.
I completely forgot about
that. Well, that's...
I think he's been unfortunate in some of the positions he's been playing.
He's played out wide. He's kind of played a wee bit deeper, certainly at Celtic. Actually got a story that'll be on the website tomorrow. He's picked up an injury. He's been playing with an injury for the past few weeks, which maybe explains why he's not been quite the same as that Robinson we saw last season. Obviously, the step up in level as well. But he's still the top scorer in all competitions from his goals in the League Cup. So they're hoping that after this international break that...
And him, the likes of Robinson and Rudden could be needed next week, because Bakayoko's...
Well, he's in Morocco. It's not too bad. It's
still travelling. He's still travelling. He's moving about.
As far as going to Africa and flights, length of flights and time zones,
he could be
stuff,
going a lot further. Yeah. But
they all get their chance. I mean, we've spoken about games being postponed, and I noticed that they've rescheduled a Livingston game as well on there. So there's a lot of fixtures coming up, and you simply cannot play with the same 11 guys week in, week out. He's going to have to utilise that squad. Everybody's going to get game time, so there'll be opportunities there.
And moving to off-field matters, just to see the hangdog look on George's face, because he hates such things. John Nelm's often strained relationship with the fans group Dee4Life is strained again.
Yeah, it keeps kind of
strange timing
on,
because things are going quite well this season, and they've had a decent start to the season. They've invested big. The new manager's got everybody excited. They've bought back the stadium. And the fans aren't happy.
Well, the fans group, Dee4Life, aren't happy, because obviously when they sold their majority shareholding to the Keys family, and John Nelm's coming in, part of that agreement was that they would have place on the board as a fans rep, and they haven't got that at the moment. So I think, I made my opinion clear in the paper yesterday that I think that would be a really good thing for the club as a whole to have that kind of arrangement in place. So it'd be good for the two sides.
Right, if it's there in the, if it's
yeah,
in,
it should be,
it's in the club's it articles, be. It should yeah, be. The only thing I got reading your story, George, was that Dee4Life seem less concerned about that than they are about the stream of information they're getting from Dens.
Yeah, no, that's
which I found a wee bit strange, because they're not like any of us.
he can tell us what he wants.
I need to put my cards on the table here. When anybody in my adult life, and I was sober, has said to me, "But it's our club." I said, "No, it's not my club. It's the club I support." I've never had any illusions about ownership. I mean, I was thinking about it on the way in. My house is about 200 years old. A lot of people lived in it before me.
Yeah.
A lot of people might, if I don't blow it up or burn it down, I'll live in it after me. But it's my house. I own it. And it's Tim Keyes and John Nairn's football club. They own it. And I get the custodian and I get the emotional attachment, and people are entitled to their own opinion. But I think while I don't understand why Dee4Life aren't pushing even harder to get back on the board, because they should have a representative on the board, because that's what the club's articles say. Saying that you want to know, you want more information. And I would make another point. I said this at the time. The fans wanted the American owners, and they got American owners. Now, if you look at American sport, American owners, some of them speak to supporters, but American owners are owners, and they decide what they tell you. And they maybe should have thought a wee bit more about that 10 years ago when the club was sold to Tim Keyes, because they're not really doing that much different from what a lot of American owners do. And if they want to tell them lots, that's great. But it's their gift. I have spoken.
I would just, yeah. There's obviously been statements and counter-statements and stuff. I would just like to see the two sides get on a wee bit.
I'll interrupt again and go on my high horse. Don't get me wrong. I'd be quite delighted for John Nelms and Tim Keyes to tell the fans, me, you, anybody who's interested, absolutely everything about the club. And I don't see what's wrong with them doing that. I don't quite understand why they don't want to speak more. But if they don't, they don't. That's their right.
On this stadium front, in terms of information, I mean, when the planning permission goes in, we will get a lot of information in that, I expect. So hopefully that comes quite soon.
I mean, I read your article as well, George. It was interesting. I mean, as a fan, the vast majority of fans don't care what goes on behind the scenes. They want to go on a Saturday and see their team winning games on a Saturday and put a smile on their face. Now, at this point in time, things are going well for Dundee. They're in the top flight. They're doing relatively well. They're in a much better position than they have been in the past. The thing that struck me was, as Tom's already touched on, if it's in the articles that they should have someone on the board, why haven't they got someone on the board?
That's a
must.
The thing that came across from John Nelms was, and this is the way it sounded to me, and he can come back if he thinks I'm wrong, he could not trust things that went on in the boardroom not to go out of the boardroom.
I think there's been issues in the past between certain people, Dee4Life, I don't know who those people are, if they're there. I don't think they're there anymore. Dee4Life have worked really hard to kind of...
Yeah, because what goes on in the boardroom should stay in the boardroom until John Nelms or Tim Keyes decide.
Yeah, there is a thing, from Dundee's point of view, strategically, it often pays to have your fans representative on the board, because they are then bound by legal rules, which means, and I know that Dee4Life way in the past, and when they ran the club, speaking to guys, they found that guys were going, "Oh, you never told us about this when it was ongoing. You never told us about that." Legally, they're not allowed to. If they're a director of the club, there are some things they're bound by. I do think, in fairness to Dee4Life, when I read John Nelms say, well, things that are commercially sensitive. Yeah. Well, things that are commercially sensitive to him might not actually be commercially sensitive to most of the rest of us. Mm. So I took that with a pinch of salt. But, I mean, as I say, a lot of it I don't understand from both sides. Like I say, hey, you should have somebody on the board, so get them on the board if you're Dundee and do things in a proper manner. But also, use that wisely. There are things that they cannot say, even to their own organisation, that have to stay in the boardroom. I don't quite understand a lot of the fuss about it.
I would very much like to get past it and stop writing about it, I have to say.
Yeah, I think people out there, and I long ago gave up when I was working full-time on sport, trying to explain to fans who I met socially that I just wanted to write about what happened on the pitch. That's what I want to do as a supporter. Now, I accepted, and increasingly during the three and a bit decades that I was a footballer, more and more and more you were writing about what happens off the pitch. And that's why I never said to folk, this is my dream job, because the dream part of the job was writing about football.
Yeah.
The business side of it, part of that was why I got into journalism and not accounts, was because I hate all that financial stuff and everything like that. And as you say, Bear, a lot of fans are like that.
Yeah.
Some fans aren't. Some fans like to know everything, and they're entitled to know that.
I'm saying that the majority of fans, and I do mean the majority of fans, are only interested in what happens on the pitch on a Saturday. But, you know, I take my hat off to these fans who run Dee4Life and the Dundee Supporters Association, because they are the people who put their head above the parapet when times were tough. And we're able to rally people together and keep the club afloat at certain points in time. But
I think that for a club like Dundee, they could be stronger for it, for having everybody together pointing the same direction.
The fans have helped Dundee much in the past that it's always been a bit strange to me that the Keys administration, if you like, didn't, that's a bad word to use in relationship with Dundee, right enough. But, for all that I'm saying, the fans are wanting to know a bit too much, maybe, and all that, I just don't understand why when there's that history of fan support on off-field matters, that they don't want a closer relationship. Yeah. But as I say, it's their money. It's their choice in a lot of ways, and most of all, what I'm enjoying about this chat is the smug smile on Alan Temple's face down the line, because you don't have these issues just now.
Oh yeah, famously Dundee United fans have always got on cracking with their owners.
You're just enjoying the current lull.
I didn't want to say anything because it's a topic that I am woefully underserved in terms of knowledge of. But what I would say is,
lucky you.
It's interesting what, you know, the comment there regarding how it could be a stronger unit if they got their heads together and came together is absolutely bang on. I mean, I don't think that, you know, the current owners of United haven't always had the most fantastic communications with their supporters groups, and there's a few supporters groups involved around the United space. But in recent years, it's been a really good relationship with the Dundee United Supporters Foundation, DUSF, and granted that's helped when the DUSF, through their supporters, put their hands in their pocket to such an extent. You know, about £500,000 towards various
Dundee
projects,
but
nonetheless, that line of communication there, that relationship that fans group have with Mark Ogren is a positive one. It's a respectful one. I think there's a level of trust on both sides. And if that could be built across the road, I think the comment there regarding being a stronger unit together rather than being a couple of factions that are increasingly bickering through public means is probably a fair one.
Yeah, I mean, Alan, is it fair to say that being an American owner and being familiar with that model where owners tend to be virtually all powerful in American sport, it took Mark Ogren a wee while to get his head round the difference here. And it might help that if Tim Keyes and John Nelms did the same. But after 10 years, I'm not really holding out much hope.
Yeah, perhaps. I mean, the initial arrival of the guys from the States was a tad before my time, but it's they're certainly whether it was due to the amount of different United fans groups at the time, whether it was due to the fact that the guys wanted to do business as they wanted to do it, and as you say, they were paid their money, so that was their prerogative. I'm not entirely sure, but I can certainly speak to the relationship that's there now, and it's a positive one. You just need to look across the road from Tannadice Park to what Gussie Park looks like now to realise what a strong relationship between a fans group and the club can be, because that facility as it is right now would not exist without the DUSF. So yeah, it's one that I could only echo the hopes that they can put their heads together and sort it out and actually have a conversation with each other rather than, you know, fractious emails and press releases, because I don't think that really does anything for anyone, does it?
So it's your fault, George. You insist they speak through you.
I'm just the messenger.
Well, hopefully by the time we return. Oh no, wait. I was about to finish there, but I forgot Scotland are playing tonight.
Just finish there.
I must have. I said this when we were coming in. Scotland are very upbeat, and in a way, it's great to see. But they're playing Spain in Seville.
It's a tough one, isn't it?
Yeah. I think it's a very tough. I would take a 2-0 move on to the next game. I must admit.
You know what? It's an opportunity for them. I mean, if you go to these championships, and hopefully we will qualify, you want to go there and show that you deserve to be there. So you're going to have to play teams like Spain.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to show that you can compete at a certain level. And I think Scotland are there now. I think Scotland, Steve Clarke's done a fantastic job. So while they go there tonight, and ideally they can get a point or even get the win, which would be fantastic. But, you know, they've bought themselves a bit of leeway in that group. And, yeah, you're right. I mean, a good performance in a defeat would not be a bad thing.
As long as Spain beat Norway on Tuesday, that's fine.
Yeah.
Because then that's a squad fight.
Well, we're doing it. So that's it, Alan. We give Spain a nice, comfortable 2-0 tonight. So spend the second half saying, slow down, boys, slow down. Conserve your energy. We're not going to tackle you. And then Spain do the business against Norway.
Camaraderie. That's it. Camaraderie. Friends across the ocean. That's what you want.
I laughed a lot at the time, but I'm worried now that we'll upset Rodri. Did you see that stat about Man City?
No, come on.
Their win ratio drops 33% when he doesn't play.
Really?
And he's angry playing for Spain against Scotland, who he described as rubbish. Well, don't want to annoy him.
He's no bad, but he's...
he's no bad.
He's not match fit. He's been fine. He's been sitting on his bum for the past few weeks.
It's good to see that even the top players, when they get beat... show sour grapes after
yeah, can it. Throw it, can, because he usually seems a very calm lad, Rodri. He just threw his toys out the pram that night. I wonder if he thought a day later, I wish it wasn't me doing the press. But George, I wonder as well, is that going to be Steve Clarke's team talk tonight? Aye, McTominay, you're marking Rodri. He's no bad, but you could cope with him.
I thought you were going to say the classic sticking the headline up on the dressing room wall, Rodri saying we're rubbish. So go for that. But McTominay, he's the man.
I hope he saved a couple of goals. He got a couple at the weekend.
He saved Manu anyway.
Yep.
I always hated those manager things. As a rubbish amateur player, they say you're rubbish. They'll obviously know me better than you do because you picked me. They wouldn't want me anywhere near the place. Anyway. That's all we've got time for this week. It's time to head out into the winter cold.